Imagine you're looking to buy a house, some place nice for you and your family. Except instead of a house, you're looking for a planet. And it's not just your future, but for all of humanity. This was the mission that faced 12 brave astronauts in Christopher Nolan's 2014 film, Interstellar. With Earth on the brink of agricultural collapse, humanity's only hope seems to be abandoning the planet in search of a new one. The Lazarus mission sent 12 astronauts to 12 candidate planets to determine which was best suited for a human colony. 10 years later, the Endurance mission launched to explore the three planets that had sent back the most promising data. In my last video about Interstellar, we covered the famous wormhole, supermassive black hole Gargantua, and how the film portrays time dilation. Today, as promised, we're diving deeper into the exoplanets the Endurance crew visited. Oh, and if you haven't seen this film yet, pause this video and go and watch it before coming back, because there will be spoilers. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Join me today as we explore the real estate of the Gargantua Pantagruel system with Miller's towering tidal waves, the icy and isolated Man's Planet, and Edmund's rocky terrain. We'll dig into what the movie got right or wrong about these exoplanets, their similarities with known planetary bodies in our own universe, and how habitable they really could be for a permanent human colony. To get started, let's brush up on Gargantua. Gargantua is a supermassive black hole some 10 billion light years from Earth, and a whopping 100 million times the mass of our Sun. Gargantua, like most genuine black holes we've discovered to date, rotates. It has lots of angular momentum which causes it to spin. As black holes spin, they also boost the rotation of their accretion disk of gas and dust. In Interstellar, this is what provides light and warmth to Gargantua's orbiting planets, Miller and Mann. Miller's planet is a water world with knee-deep oceans and 1,200-meter tidal waves. It orbits incredibly close to Gargantua, just on the cusp of the event horizon. But wouldn't this kind of proximity be too dangerous and volatile to be habitable? Is this kind of proximity to a black hole even realistic? Actually, some researchers say it is. They argue these so-called planets wouldn't be so different from planets orbiting stars. But rather than form in a star's protoplanetary disk, they are thought to form in the black hole's accretion disk when ice-covered dust particles collide and fuse. Eventually, they gain enough mass to have a gravitational pull of their own, drawing more and more matter in until a hard planet is formed. Okay, so if planets do exist, what is their space environment like? Well, for starters, black holes emit a lot of radiation, primarily through hot accreting gas. This accretion power is immense, orders of magnitude more than anything we could get from nuclear fusion. One paper suggests a planet like Miller would be completely surrounded by a 6,000 degree black body radiation field. Dr. Thorne, the Nobel Prize winning physicist who consulted on the film, disagrees. In his book, The Science of Interstellar, he argues instead that Gargantua's disk is comparable in temperature to our Sun's surface, so emits lots of light, but little to no X-rays or gamma rays. He also says the accretion disk is super thin and confined to Gargantua's equatorial plane. Such disks are actually possible around black holes that haven't ripped up a star in the last million years or so, so I suppose the film doesn't actually veer off from reality there. Unlikely, but not impossible. Okay, but how can Miller maintain a stable orbit around a black hole as large as Gargantua? Like planets orbiting our own Sun, Miller's planet has its own motion. If it was going fast enough to escape the Sun's gravity, it would shoot right past. However, if it was going slowly, it would get pulled in entirely by the Sun's gravity. The same is true for Gargantua. A planet in a stable orbit would only be possible if Miller's planet was going fast enough not to be pulled into Gargantua's immense gravitational pull, but not so fast that it shoots right past it. Though this seems virtually impossible, Dr. Thorne hypothesized a sweet spot that could exist where the centrifugal force of the planet balances out the gravitational force pulling it inwards. However, the real issue isn't the planet's orbit, it's the planet's formation. Is it even possible for smaller, slower objects to coagulate together to form a planetary body so close to a black hole? In 2019, a group of physicists showed it is possible, but only if the planet formed within the accretion disk. Dr. Thorne aligns with this in his book and takes it a step further, stating that it's actually not possible for Miller's planet to exist outside the accretion disk. This presents a problem, as in the film, we see the planet orbiting well beyond the accretion disk. It is in the wrong place as far as the physics is concerned. But sometimes you have to take creative license and decide on fiction over fact to get more visually impactful images like this one. Being so close to a black hole brings out another quirky feature, time dilation. In the film, time on Miller passes 60,000 times slower than on Earth. Given where the planet is located, would time dilation actually be this severe? While researching this video, I came across differing opinions. Some think yes, it is possible, while others deny it, saying time dilation is only felt once you're inside the accretion disk, much closer than Miller's location in the film. According to Dr. Kip, for this kind of time dilation to be realistic, Gargantua would have to spin at 1 in 100 trillion parts slower than the maximum spin possible for a black hole of that size. Incredibly unlikely, but technically not impossible. We can't discuss Miller's planet without discussing its waves. Being so close to Gargantua, it is under enormous tidal gravity. Dr. Thorne wrote that this most likely would make Miller's planet football-shaped along its equator, bulging strongly toward and away from the black hole. He also postulates that being this close to the black hole, Miller's planet would have to be tidally locked. I'm not sure how a tidally locked planet would be able to remain a water world. Surely half the world would be ice and the other half super hot. But if we continue the thread from earlier and accept that Miller's planet was meant to be located in the middle of Gargantua's accretion disk, then the heat wouldn't be one-sided anyway. Speaking of water, let's talk about Miller's waves. The film would have you believe that being subjected to such intense tidal forces gives rise to the colossal tidal waves we see on screen. They can be compared to tides here on Earth, which are dictated by our sun's and moon's gravitational forces, but on a much larger scale. Dr. Thorne himself admits that the only way he can make the equations work is by making Miller's planet rock back and forth relative to Gargantua. But that would require a third body, very close by, like another large planet, to keep its orbit eccentric. A second theory he proposes is that the tidal forces deform the planet's crust, leading to enormous tsunamis, but that still depends on something rocking the planet. Perhaps the best Miller analog we know of is Jupiter's moon, Europa. Much like Miller's planet, Europa has an eccentric orbit, arising from the gravity of the other Galilean moons tugging on it. This orbit also cracks its crust a lot, and creates tides in its subsurface ocean that stretch and relax the moon's surface. Overall, Miller's planet doesn't seem to be very hospitable at all, as the crew of the Endurance mission would discover. The film got this right, so we follow our protagonist to the next destination. The second planet the Endurance crew visits is Man's planet. It's a harsh, icy world, also orbiting Gargantua, though not quite as closely as Miller's does. There's no mention of time dilation here, but there are other unique features that make this planet fascinating. As we discover through the course of the film, Dr. Mann falsified data to make his planet appear more habitable than it actually was, in order to be rescued by a future crew. He claimed there was a rocky surface below, with breathable air and organic material, though this was never actually found. Instead, the whole planet seems to be a frozen world, a large sponge-like network of ice mountains, caves, and crevices surrounding big voids, with frozen clouds in the upper atmosphere. In order for frozen clouds to remain suspended, they have to be less dense than the atmosphere. Call me a skeptic, but this seems highly unlikely. Dr. Thorne theorizes the clouds are most likely frozen CO2, which has a density of 1.55 grams per centimeter cubed, assuming Earth's atmospheric pressure. An ammonia-rich atmosphere would be closer to 0.00077 grams per centimeter cubed. No chance of floating dry ice in ammonia gas, unless the atmospheric pressure on Man is wildly different to where these numbers would change drastically. In any case, the film doesn't go into any explanations about this, so we'll just assume creative liberty was taken here to emphasize the visual differences between Miller's and Man's planets. It is thought these ice clouds sublimate, repeatedly freezing and evaporating, then freezing again. It's thought that this could be due to the eccentricity of Man's orbit about Gargantua, which causes the planet to heat up and cool off, depending on its distance from the black hole. It seems Nolan took a lot of artistic license with Man's planet. Because of this, it's hard to compare it to anything in our universe. So far, we haven't discovered any exoplanets with ammonia-rich atmospheres. We have found plenty of cold exoplanets, though. This exoplanet, an icy super-Earth 21,500 light-years away, is one of the coldest known exoplanets we know of, reaching temperatures as low as minus 220 degrees Celsius. Like Man's planet, it is not a good candidate for a human colony. Let's turn our attention to Edmund's planet. After leaving Man's planet, Cooper and Brand don't have enough fuel to make it to Edmund's planet, orbiting the star Pantagruel 1 light-year away. After slingshotting around Gargantua at a cost of 51 years due to time dilation, Cooper jettisons himself to shed weight from the Endurance and get Dr. Brand to Edmund's planet. However, it's unclear how Brand would have decelerated into orbit around Edmund's. One option is by slingshotting around another black hole, but this isn't shown in the film. Edmund's is a rocky planet with clouds and a breathable atmosphere. From this, we assume it to also have a surface water source and a biological source of oxygen gas. This could be from soil bacteria, which is assumed to be compatible with Earth-based life since the film closes with a human colony populating Edmund's planet. Edmund shares many similarities with Earth: similar gravity, breathable air, arable soil, and potentially liquid water. It doesn't appear to be tidally locked either. Some interstellar fans compare Edmund's to an ancient Mars back when it had oceans. By the end of the film, Edmund's planet is shown as a viable option for human colonization. We just need to develop hypersleep pods and find a nearby wormhole first. And with that, our grand tour comes to a close. So, which planet is most likely to be able to support a human colony? As we explored, Edmund seems the only viable option, even though we didn't see much of it. But I suppose that would have made for a much less exciting movie. Overall, the film did a pretty good job of trying to remain scientifically accurate. A few creative liberties were taken to enhance the storytelling, but that's why we go to see a sci-fi movie instead of a lecture. The power of science fiction is its ability to make us dream. And even though we are very far from colonizing other Earth-like planets, Interstellar does just that. It encourages us to keep that spark of wonder alive. Maybe there's someone out there looking longingly out at us too. Which planet would you most like to visit? Let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching, and see you next time. Out in our solar system, rocks of various sizes, compositions, and origins are pulled along by the gravity of our star. Many of them are billions of years old. Some fall into our planet's gravity well, heating up to 1,800 degrees Celsius as they fight against the friction of our atmosphere. Not much makes it to the surface, less than 5% of each meteorite, which means that to have a piece of meteorite of your own is a very special thing. Which is why I am a big fan of the sponsor of today's video, Gentle Bands. Gentle Bands craft impeccable, exquisite rings with unique materials such as the meteorite used in the treasure ring, featured in their Cosmos collection, meaning you can take a piece of space around with you wherever you go. Just look at these stunning designs in their newly launched Galactic Legends range. Drawing inspiration from classic sci-fi films and games, this Imperial Might Ring, or my personal favorite, the Star Navigator, are designed to perfectly capture the essence of our enchanting universe and the eternal battles between dark and light. Gentle Band's family-owned workshops use sustainably harvested and gathered materials to make rings that are truly unique and a pleasure to wear. There's free engraving and free lifetime replacement if you ever lose it, for those unaccustomed to rings on fingers or anyone seeking versatility. You can choose from a selection of convenient chains as an alternative way to wear your distinctive piece. So why not follow my link in the description below for an exclusive 25% off when you use the code ASTRUM25. Thanks for watching. Making this video required some long-term planning and work, which we were only able to do thanks to the consistency and sustainability of your memberships as Astronauts on Patreon. A huge thank you to everyone who has signed up. And if you'd like us to make more videos like this, you can join with the link down below. When you join, you'll be able to watch the whole video ad-free, see your name in the credits, and submit questions to our team. Once again, a huge thank you from myself and the whole ASTRUM team. Meanwhile, click the link to this playlist for more ASTRUM content. I'll see you next time.